Good afternoon. If you have seats left in your row, can you scoot to the center, please, for people who are coming in and need a space, or maybe even raise up a hand if you've got a spot next to you for people in the back. But we are ready to go.
Good afternoon and Merry Christmas Eve. My name is Mandy Dupar. I'm the pastor to students and families.
And my name is Paige Chase, and I'm pastor of family ministry.
We are so happy to see you all. It is a packed house. This is so fun. As a reminder, if you have an empty seat next to you, if you could scooch in, that would help us out so that people in the back can find seats. Or if you have an empty seat next to you right now, if you just want to like kind of put a hand up and show people that there are spots next to you, that would be awesome. One other way that you could help us out this afternoon is if you could put your phone on silent or vibrate. That would help cut out some distractions. Speaking of distractions, there are a lot of young people in here, which is so awesome. You're not a distraction. I did not mean to make that correlation. I meant to say that we know that there will be wiggles and noise and giggles and all kinds of fun in this service, and we love that and we welcome that. If you are a parent, though, and you want to give your child more space to play or to run around, the breezeway or the alcove is open back there. The cry room is also open if you need to utilize that. So we are going to transition into a time of worship. We have been lighting candles in this Advent season to symbolize the light of God coming into the world through the arrival of his son, Jesus. These lights remind us of the tremendous blessings that we receive through Jesus, the light of the world.
The first Advent candle is lit to remind us of the hope that Christ gives us. The second candle speaks of the peace that only Jesus can bring. The third candle symbolizes the joy that we have because of Jesus' coming into the world as our Savior. And the fourth candle represents the love of God in sending his Son to us. And finally, we light the center candle, which is the Christ candle, as we remember the humble way that Christ came, that God came into the world. We give thanks. He came not for the wise and the powerful, and not just for those of us who have our lives all put together, but he came for the weak and for the weary, for the broken. It's good news for those of us who know that we need a Savior. If that describes you, we can rejoice. Christ is born for you. So let's begin our time together by giving praise to him.
So please join us in this responsive reading. It's super easy and you can follow along with me. I'm going to read a phrase and then you will answer by saying, "We welcome you with praise." So let's begin. Is it up there? Perfect. Jesus, King of glory, splendor of the Father, eternal light.
We welcome you with praise.
Jesus, Son of the living God, Son of the Virgin Mary, Son of righteousness.
We welcome you with praise.
Jesus, wonderful counselor, everlasting Lord, Prince of Peace.
We welcome you with praise.
Jesus, gentle and humble of heart, our helper and our defender.
We welcome you. Jesus,
friend of all, brother of the poor, source of life and holiness.
We welcome you with praise.
Jesus, goodness without measure, unending wisdom, our way and our life.
We welcome you with praise.
Will you pray with me? Great God of light and love, we thank you for humbling yourself to come to us as one of us. Let the reality of your presence with us shape our perspective through all the joys and trials of life so that we may know the hope and the peace and joy and love of Christ. And even as we celebrate tonight your first coming as a baby, we look forward with expectancy to your next coming in glory. Prepare us for that day. Grant that all of us may be found in Christ when you come again to judge the world and to set all things right. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's go ahead and stand together and sing songs of praise.
Thank you.
be seated. Well, the Christmas season is not just a time where we celebrate principles or feelings like hope and peace and joy. We celebrate a story that was lived out in history. So I invite our scripture readers to come on up now, and we're going to hear the story that lies behind it all.
At that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire.
All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for this census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home.
He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child.
And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son.
She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there is no lodging available for them.
That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep.
Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them.
They were terrified, but the angel reassured them.
"Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger."
Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of the heaven, praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased."
When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other,
"Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger.
After seeing him, the shepherds told everybody what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child.
All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished, but Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often.
The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them.
Let's sing together.
Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation.
thought you said we lost him.
I found you all. Thank goodness for that star. If it weren't for that star, I wouldn't have found you guys.
Pretty convenient that now you can read the stars.
Oh no, just that big super bright one. I mean, it's like, blam! But I'm still gonna need directions home. Can someone write that down for me?
We don't have time for this. We're going to see the Messiah.
Look at us, the four wise men. We're inseparable.
More like insufferable.
Speaking of suffering, my feet can't take much more walking. It's been 3 years. We should have been home by now.
You guys can blame me all day for losing those camels, but you all knew going into this that my double hitch knot needed a little work.
Why don't we proceed in silence, reverent silence, in honor of the Messiah?
Totally cool with that.
Good.
So, I was thinking about my gift. I mean, what baby needs white jade anyway, right?
We've been over this 1,000 times. White jade represents his purity and goodness. The gold represents his royalty. The burning of frankincense reminds us that the aura of God is around us at all times, and the myrrh is to anoint him as King of Kings.
Right. Just listen. I think I found a better gift. A gift that'll make everyone forget that I lost the white jade.
You what?
I mean, I think a gift that makes the white jade just look like nothing. A gift that's better than the white jade that I replaced.
You replaced with what?
The greatest gift of all. Oh yeah. Wait for it. Ba-blam! Hummus!
You must be kidding.
Do you mean you must be kidding? Because I'm not kidding at all. Hummus is delicious, okay? And it's very symbolic. People unite together when they see hummus. Much like a savior. Okay. This is my bad. This is on me. You guys go see the Messiah. I'll just stay here.
I think that would be best. But at least you have a snack.
Yeah. I just thought, it just doesn't matter what we bring this little king. He doesn't need any of our gifts. I mean, you know, he's a savior. I mean, he's a gift to us. Maybe I was hoping he's bigger than all my mistakes. Yeah, I guess that's what I was hoping. All right, I'll see you guys later. Why are you doing that?
Because I hope he's that kind of a savior, too.
Let's go. I wish someone had some pita bread.
Ba-blam!
Okay, a little levity is always a good thing on Christmas season, but more than that, we're hoping that wherever you came from tonight, you hear a message that there is a Savior that has been born that is bigger than all of our mistakes. We're not here to put on a show tonight or a performance. We're here to remember the good news about Jesus. One of my favorite parts about every Christmas Eve is getting to hear about how this the Savior has transformed real lives in our midst. And so I'm going to invite Glyn up to share a little bit of her story tonight of how this amazing Savior, Jesus, the one who came into the world, has transformed her life. So would you welcome Glyn to the stage?
Hello, everyone. Oh, there we go. Let's get situated real quick. Well, it's such a joy to be with everyone here today, and I just want to take a moment to pray and invite God into this time. So if you could all bow your heads, close your eyes. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for every person here today. Thank you for bringing us all here safely.
Thank you that you are the author of our lives. Holy Spirit, as I share part of my story that you have written in my life, I pray that you speak through me today. Thank you for preparing the hearts of those here to receive what it is that you have for them. May we all come to see you more clearly and know the depths of your love for us, helping us turn to you and serve you all the days of our lives. Amen. All right, well, hello everyone. My name is Glyn, and I have been coming to SBCC since March of this year. I was born and raised actually in Santa Barbara, but I was not raised in the church. I actually didn't really have a close relationship with anybody who loved Jesus until I went to college. And so I went to college in 2011 down in Orange County, and that's where I met a few really dear friends. And one of those friends became a very close friend of mine, and I got very close with her family as well. And I started working with their company after college for about 6 years. And so over the course of those 6 years, they really exposed me to their love for Jesus and his lordship in their lives. I would like to say that I was thrown into the deep end of Christianity. I kind of saw it all, to be honest. And through that, I was surrounded by believers, yet I didn't really subscribe to their beliefs. Meanwhile, I was seeking out information kind of anywhere and everywhere to help me understand how to handle the pain in my life. I had started to experience severe back pain and back spasms that would sometimes put me out for a week or more. It led me to start to ask bigger life questions, like, why am I here? Why am I going through this pain? And if this is what life becomes, is it even really worth living? Looking back, my pride didn't want God to be the answer. I had previously said that people who needed God were weak and just couldn't handle life. I didn't want to admit that I actually felt weak and lost in the chaos of life. As part of this journey, I started to seek healing in various places. I heard a podcast and a shaman talk about a more universal God, about a spirit and the power that we had to heal ourselves through meditation. So I tried one evening and was shocked midway when I felt an overwhelming surge of energy pushing through my body. I lost complete feeling of my hands and my mouth, and it really freaked me out. So I tried to get up and regain movement, and I couldn't for over a minute. It was truly an out-of-body experience. And up until this point, I only believed in the physical world. I thought that anyone who believed in the spiritual world was delusional. But after this experience, what I thought to be impossible was now suddenly possible. There was an element to my existence that I didn't understand, and I was worried that I had just experienced the darker side of it. About 6 months later, I found myself wanting to make the trip down to Orange County to go to a church service with the family of a church that the family had started, who I was close to down there. They had a guest speaker, and I really felt the pull to be there. At the end of the service, I was about to leave, really wondering why I'd even come. And that's when a woman who I didn't know at the time, but had heard about through friends, came up to me and asked if she could pray for me. I said yes, and she proceeded to pray over me for about 20 minutes. In these 20 minutes, God spoke through her and called out the past meditation experience along with many other aspects of my seeking journey. He read me like a book and explained me better than I could explain myself. I felt him saying, "I see you, I know you, I created you, and I love you. Come follow me." The gospel I had heard up until that point just hit me like a ton of bricks. It had not set in until this moment. I just knew Jesus, in fact, was the Son of God, and he has been with me this whole time. This realization rocked me to my core, and I was humbled and completely repentant. I came home, changed, and took a 180 turn toward him ever since. I have been learning what it looks like to live for him. And the first time that I prayed when I got home after that visit, I was in my room, and when I prayed, the same sensation came to the same parts of my body that night, but it was completely warm and comforting and just loving and joyful. And I cried tears of joy instead of the tears of fear that I had cried during that meditation experience. And that was the first taste of God really being restoration in my life. See, here's the thing. As we seek him, he will meet us in our seeking. The Father promises in Jeremiah 29:13, "You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord." And in this seeking, he met me so intimately. He humbled me and helped me realize how much I didn't know. He lovingly revealed the sin in my life, the areas of my life that had come against who he had created me to be. He took a prideful, logical, and seemingly strong young woman who believed only in the natural world and completely flipped my perspective. As it is written in 1 Corinthians 1:27-31, "But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord." If you would have told me I would be up here boasting in the Lord 4 years ago, I would have laughed in your face and probably said some snide comment. Yet 3.5 years ago, I encountered the living God, who instructed me to stay in touch with him and walk out when he called me. I had no idea what that would look like then, and now I am in awe of all the doors that he has opened and asked me to walk through. I could have never imagined I would be walking in such trusting obedience with the Lord, but God did. I can't even put into words how amazing life with him is. I honestly can't believe I ever did life without knowing him. So with that, I would like to close us in a prayer using some lyrics I was actually listening to in a worship song this morning when preparing this message. So once again, if you could bow your heads, close your eyes. Lord, it is my heart's desire for us all to know you and be known by you, Jesus. Hide us deep inside your heart, Lord. Cover us with your wings. Bring us into safety. Bring us into fellowship with who you are, Father, Son, and Spirit. I pray this is all we long for. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord indeed. And thank you, Glyn, for sharing some of your life with us. Let's go ahead and stand and respond with praise to this great God.
Our dear Savior.
You may be seated.
Death is lost and victory won. You were born to change it all. Warrior, though frail and small.
Just a baby sleeping in a manger. All the world was waiting for you.
again, welcome to Santa Barbara Community Church and Merry Christmas. My name is Benji, and I have the privilege of serving as one of the pastors in this church family, and I especially want to welcome anyone who may be new or visiting. I know there are people here from out of town, and so if that's you, would you raise your hand if you're here from out of town? And I also want to know where you came from, so shout it out. This is the interactive portion. All those places. I love it. That's great. I thought at first about having people who are hosting raise their hands, and I thought, no, you're probably too tired from setting up your house to host, so just rest. Good to be here. I grew up in a family. My parents both were born and raised in Idaho's Treasure Valley, and they moved to California a few months before I was born, and so growing up, almost all of my extended family still lived in Idaho, and every few years, there would be some subset of grandparents or uncles, aunts, cousins who would come and spend Christmas with my family in California. Now, anytime out-of-town family was coming, it was a big deal, but especially at Christmas. And we would spend the whole week before prepping the house, getting out plates I didn't know we owned, and that table runner thing that only comes out once a year. And by we, I really mean my mom would spend the entire week before prepping to get our house ready for Christmas. And funny enough, this actually reminds me a little bit of the Christmas story. There are four books in our Bible that we call Gospels, and that word simply means good news. The books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John each attempt to give an account of the life of Jesus from a slightly different angle. And because each of them has a particular perspective, they all begin the story of Jesus's life in different ways. Now, they don't tell different stories, but no two of them starts in exactly the same manner. So, for example, Mark's gospel skips entirely over Jesus's childhood and begins with his ministry as an adult. We've already heard some of how Luke tells Jesus's amazing birth story when James and Selah and Sebastian read for us. Matthew's gospel begins similarly with Jesus' childhood, and it includes the story of the wise men, although there is no mention of hummus, just in case you were curious. But then there's John's gospel, and John's gospel does something really different. The apostle John, he goes back even further than Matthew and Luke. In fact, he goes back as far as possible. Here's how John begins his gospel. He says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made." Now, we may not realize it now, but the opening words of John's good news account of Jesus's life, well, it would have been very provocative to his original readers. If you, like many of John's original readers, had grown up learning the story of the people of Israel by heart, you would undoubtedly have noticed that John begins his gospel with the very same words that open the Hebrew Scriptures. Genesis, the first book of the Bible, declares, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." And now John, who himself grew up a faithfully observant Jew, he dares to not only use that same phrase, "in the beginning," but then he goes on to assign the work of creation to a figure called the Word. And you'll notice that just in these couple of verses, everything most of us imagine about a godlike creature is associated with the one called the Word. John insists that the Word is eternal, the Word is powerful, the Word is creator. All of this serves to underline John's dramatic claim that the Word was God. Now, in the ancient world, as in our world, there were any number of God stories loose in the wild. There were stories of angry gods and permissive gods, stories of aloof gods and vindictive gods, stories of oppressive gods, and even stories of incompetent gods. And as cosmically marvelous as these opening verses are, they don't yet tell us much that wouldn't have been considered pretty run-of-the-mill, down the middle, for most of these God stories. Frankly, any deity worth its salt should at least be able to claim pre-existence, impressive strength, and some role in creation. And if John stopped here, we could easily add this Word character alongside Tiamat or Baal, Zeus or Dormammu. But these verses are the on-ramp, and John is about to hit fourth gear, because in a little later in the chapter, he says this, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Christmas, we celebrate a birth. But John reminds us that this birth is unlike any before or since. At Christmas, we celebrate the stunning truth that God himself became human and moved into his own creation. Over the past few years, my family has enjoyed watching this show called Lego Masters. Anyone else Lego Masters fans in the room? If you've seen Lego Masters, you already know that the way it works is that teams of two use Lego bricks to put their creativity on display through a series of challenges. Week after week, my family has loved watching these teams. They start with a concept and they race against the clock to try to make their vision a reality. Apparently, 12 hours is not a very long time to create a Lego creation. We've seen some really remarkable builds that have really delighted us. We've seen some humorous characters, some epic battles, whimsical lands. What we have yet to see, however, is a team of builders choose to inhabit the world they've built by becoming minifigures themselves. We've watched every episode, and we have not yet seen that. Now, full disclosure, I know that that idea sounds absurd to our oh-so-enlightened ears. But John's dramatic true claim in this verse is just as revolutionary. John makes clear that the Word is the Creator God who is responsible for everything that is, the God who made everything out of nothing, the God who envisioned kangaroos and kidneys, who dreamed up giant sequoias and giant squids, who conceived fireflies and fingerprints, who made everything that can be held by either telescope or microscope. And this same Word, this very God, took on human flesh and was born of a woman and placed in a manger in Bethlehem. This stunning event is what Christians call the incarnation, when the eternal Son of the Father became fully human while remaining fully God. And it simply has no precedent or parallel. And when you might ask, why would he do it? Well, every good story features conflict, an obstacle to be overcome or a problem to be solved. And the conflict that lies at the heart of the story of the Bible is simply this: the distance and disruption that humans experience from the God who created this world out of love. That distance was created when humans chose to follow their own path and their own way rather than the one laid out by God. And the result was alienation from the Father. But John tells us that in the birth of Jesus, God in the flesh, we see the Father. We see the Father's character clearly, a character marked by grace and truth. Now, if most of us go to great lengths to prepare our homes for out-of-town guests and then welcome them with open arms upon their arrival, we might expect that the arrival of the Creator God in his world would be met with shouts of joy and open hearts. But John has another surprise for us in this chapter. He says, he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. I can't think of many verses in the Bible that more succinctly paint a picture of the state of a world turned away from God's good rule. The distance and disruption was caused by sin, and it is so complete that the arrival of the Word was met with widespread rejection. And yet this book is known as a gospel for a reason. There is good news. And John says, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. Friends, this is the most beautiful announcement. When God looked upon rebellious people stuck in sin and bent on living according to their own will rather than God's, he responded by moving into the neighborhood to win hearts back to himself. And those who, by the power of his Spirit, do recognize Jesus as the eternal Word who took on flesh to bridge the gap between humanity and God, well, they're not only saved from God's righteous judgment against sin, but they're adopted as his children and made heirs of the King. This is the most gospel thing of all. This is the greatest good news there is. The God who created the world out of love has done the work to bridge the gulf between himself and all people. He sent his Son, born as a baby and destined to die on a cross as a man to pay for the sins of all people. And I wonder this evening, are you among those who have responded rightly to the arrival of Jesus, the eternal Word of God? Have you received him and believed so that you might know the joy of adoption into the family of God? Have you thrown open the doors of your heart and your life to welcome the God who came to earth to save and to restore and to redeem and adopt? At Christmas, we celebrate that God dwelt with us so that we could dwell with him today and forevermore. And there is no better day than Christmas Eve than to welcome the eternal Son of God made flesh into your heart and your life. I want you to know, if that's new to you, there's no magic formula, there's no properly worded prayer that you have to know to approach God. John reminds us that it is simply an act of faith to say, Jesus, I receive you as God incarnate. I believe in your sacrifice as the acceptable offering to pay for my sins. And to such hearts, God extends the gift of adoption. So I want to give us a moment of silence. And in that moment of silence, I want to allow each of us to just pray silently whatever you need to say to God. Perhaps you've heard something tonight for the very first time and you think, man, I want to respond to that offer of grace for the first time in my life. Or perhaps you've known and tasted that grace before, but your heart has not been living fully for the kingship of Jesus. Or perhaps you brought a concern or a burden here and you think, if there's really a God that is that generous, I want to tell him what it is. I don't know what it is that you need to say to God, but I trust that the Spirit does. So I want to give us just a moment in silence so that you can tell God whatever you need to in this brief moment of quiet. We will continue in our worship in a moment, but before I finish, I want to speak to any who may have responded today for the very first time to God's offer of grace through Jesus. If that's you, I urge you not to leave here today without telling somebody this good news. The Christian life is never meant to be lived alone, but always in the context of brothers and sisters doing life with Jesus together. You need others alongside you to encourage you, to celebrate your new faith, to pray for you, and to challenge you in your new life as a child of God. Tell someone what God has done in your heart here this afternoon. And whether tonight you've experienced God's grace for the first time or you have simply been reminded again of a story that has shaped your life for years, it is my prayer that we each leave here with a renewed sense of awe and wonder at the glory of the incarnation when God moved into our neighborhood. I can think of no better way to respond than to continue to sing in grateful response to the God who came to save. Let's continue in our worship.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so
silent night, holy night.
stand together. Lord Jesus, thank you for coming. We celebrate your arrival. We welcome you with praise. And we pray that you would find our hearts an inviting place for you to be. Lord, we remember those words in John that when the light came into the darkness did not receive the light. And we want to say to you, Lord, come and have your way in us. Shine your light in us. Lord, we need you. You indeed are a great Savior. And so, Lord, we celebrate the fact that you are kind and gentle. You're full of love and compassion. You're holy, and yet you are excited to come and make your home within us. And so we celebrate this Christmas with the hope and the joy and the peace and the love that are found in Christ. And we praise you, Lord Jesus, and it's in your name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's go with one more song. Tonight, all of us would leave in wonder of his love for us and make room in our hearts. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this Christmas and forevermore. Merry Christmas. Have a great week.